Everybody, Father Tony here, and we're talking with Khalil Andani, who is a PhD candidate from Harvard University, and he is studying esoteric Islam, mysticism, and other interesting things. He's here to talk to us about Ismaili Islam and how it relates to how we understand Gnosticism and all that stuff. And to help me do that, Jonathan Stewart is here as usual. Hello, Jonathan.
Hello, Father Tony. Hello, Khalil.
Hello.
So we had an interesting conversation in the beginning of the video part. We talked a little bit about what Ismaili Islam is in general, and then we talked about some interesting esoteric stuff. So let's continue that. When we talk about esoteric Islam and the Ismaili branch communities in general, the Imam plays a very important role. There is a, in this unbroken chain of imams, what's different from imam to imam? How does the spiritual practice change? Does the esoteric interpretation change?
That's a very good question, and it's hard to answer generally because there have been to date, 49 imams. if one can't speak to the academic study of Ismaili history only started in 1930s. Mm. So we're learning more as we recover more texts. Mm. And many things we thought we knew are revised a few years later. But,
much like Gnosticism.
Right, yeah, fair enough, So it's the Ismaili tradition is an esoteric tradition both in sort of like the technical sense, but it's also esoteric in the academic sense that very few people study this academically using proper methods. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to undertake an academic study of Ismaili history and intellectual history, bringing to bear the best methods of research, both textual methods as well as what they call the study of religion and intellectual history. So how do things change from imam to imam? Well, definitely there have been periods in the history of the Ismailis where the community as a whole has been persecuted. Mm-hmm. And during certain periods for about spans of 100 to 200 years, even the imams have to live incognito. Mm-hmm. So what usually happens is the imam in the past, in pre-modern times, the imam taught the community through a network of teachers. Mm-hmm. This used to be called the Ismaili summons, or just the summons of truth. Mm-hmm. So the imam's teaching was being conveyed on an ongoing basis, but it was being conveyed through this network of teachers, through a teaching hierarchy, and it was a hierarchy of initiation. So one would initially have access to certain levels of knowledge, and then with more practices and with more commitment, one got access to higher levels of knowledge. What does happen once in a while is that due to an imam coming out of concealment, there are changes. Mm. So in 909, the 11th Ismaili imam came out of concealment and he founded the Fatimid Empire, the Fatimid Caliphate. Mm-hmm. And that led to some major changes in the leadership of the community in terms of the laws of the new state, because the imam was taking direct control of this new state. Mm-hmm. And even for members of the Ismaili summons at that point, it was different adjusting to a hands-on imam as opposed to an incognito imam.
Yeah.
That's one example. Another example, of course, is and we're not sure exactly how it works. We don't have texts available, but some imams have come and made sort of theological interventions. So certain imams have encouraged, for example, the use of Neoplatonism. Mm-hmm. The 14th imam, it's reported, encouraged his own teaching hierarchy to use Neoplatonic ideas, or he legitimated it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that meant that sort of unofficially, Neoplatonic cosmology and metaphysics became the sort of most popular form of esoteric discourse for the Fatimid Empire. Mm. That's very interesting, an empire that is using Neoplatonic thought, and that's because an imam endorsed it. Today, there have been major changes because in the late 19th century and going through the 20th century, the last two imams have made contact with Ismaili communities around the world that were previously isolated.
Oh.
So many Ismaili ritual practices were updated.
Hmm.
The imam prescribed new forms of prayer to unite all these different communities under one prayer form,
mm-hmm.
To solidify a sense of pan-Ismaili identity. So mm-hmm. the ritual changes are another thing that mm-hmm. may differ from imam to imam.
I bet the internet has made that very easy.
Yes. Yeah.
As all religion has changed in the in the 21st century a little bit, I think.
Well, some have referred to the current Ismaili imam's domain as a authority without territory.
Hmm.
So one author from the Institute of Ismaili Studies just wrote a book, his name is Dariush Pour, called Authority Without Territory, and he sort of examined how does the imam's authority work in modern times,
mm-hmm.
and how is the imam using an institutional network to exercise his authority to improve the quality of life of not just the Ismailis, but all people. So mm-hmm. today, the current Aga Khan is the chairman of the Aga Khan Development Network, probably one of the world's largest group of agencies that work in the third world, but in now many other places in the realms of healthcare, education, culture, all these different sectors. So for example, they run several schools, a couple of universities, many hospitals, and this is all done under the Aga Khan Development Network, and this is an institutional framework by which the imam is accomplishing the mission of social justice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm bringing this up because while the Ismaili tradition has always been very Gnostic, in the view of the current imamate, spirituality obligates one to engage the world.
Mm-hmm.
Spirituality is not something that is a retreat from the world. And this is something we haven't seen other imams do because, you know, they didn't have the means. So that's a major shift.
Mm. We've had that conversation here on the show a bunch about Gnosticism in general and how you can really kind of shut yourself off and the world is bad and I don't want to have anything to do with it. But if we believe, as we do, that each person contains that spark of the divine, then it's almost a requirement that you have to do something to help your fellow people make their lives a little bit better while we while we have the opportunity to do so. So absolutely.
One of the key messages of the current Aga Khan that he repeats over and over, people have come and said, "Oh, the work you do, this is philanthropy, or it's entrepreneurship." He says, "No, it's none of those things," because in the outlook of most Muslims, faith and everyday life are really part of the same thing,
mm-hmm.
right? So this secular religious binary actually is not accepted here.
Mm-hmm.
At the individual level, that means the ethics of one's faith must inform every decision,
sure.
whether it's business, whether it's socializing, whether you're at a party. You would continue to practice the ethics of your spiritual tradition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Could we? We already touched on it, and we touched on it a bit in the video portion. But some of the points of comparison between Neoplatonism and kind of Ismaili thought and cosmology. If you could kind of get into some specifics there, and actually with that question, you left me some notes in brackets, which is God, Word of God, Universal Intellect, Universal Soul, and Cosmos. So I was wondering if you could talk about some of these concepts and their connections to Neoplatonic thought.
Yeah, I just watched a video today that you did back in 2013 where you talked about this.
Yes, when I read the statements on your guys' website, there's remarkable resonance. So I'll sort of begin the way your website begins.
Sure.
So firstly, Neoplatonism really becomes prominent in Ismaili discourses in the early to mid 10th century. It may have been there before that, but it's hard to track that. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, before Neoplatonism became like, the trade of Ismaili thought, they had a system of metaphysics that properly is called Gnostic.
Hmm.
But one theme of both systems is this notion that God is absolutely one, absolutely transcendent. So God transcends all attributes, mm-hmm. all names. Even if Scripture names God through 99 names or 300 names, God in his reality is above those names.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, unknowable.
Mm-hmm.
So this is apophatic theology.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just a negative theology. So for example, it's not enough to say God is not knowing and not living and not powerful and not merciful, because that actually doesn't result in God. That results in some non-entity that yeah. has nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So Ismaili philosophers actually said that if you want to use human language to talk about God, we need to use double negation.
Mm.
So we would say God is not powerful and not powerful. God
oh.
is not knowing and not knowing. So that's sort of the first thing regarding God.
Mm-hmm.
For those who are familiar with the Christian tradition, it is quite resonant with the concept of divine simplicity,
mm-hmm.
which is, of course, in the thought of Thomas Aquinas. I believe it's part of the catechism of the Catholic Church, even to this day.
Mm-hmm.
So all this apophatic negations results from divine simplicity, because a being that has real attributes is not simple.
Mm-hmm.
It's composite. It has parts. And philosophically speaking, an entity that has parts is caused by the union of those parts.
Mm-hmm.
But then something caused cannot be God.
Yeah.
So that's how they justified this position. Then it goes further. God is the continuous creator and sustainer of all existence. So we're not talking about a God who simply creates at the beginning of time at mm-hmm. some big bang and then sort of leaves it.
Yeah.
We're talking about God who himself transcends time and space. So therefore, everything that exists eternally depends on God. And where there's a difference from standard Neoplatonism is that the method of, or the means of divine creation is not emanation. It is rather an act of will or command. So to put it symbolically, this unknowable God, for reasons we will never fathom, but this Godhead, this transcendent Godhead, symbolically says be, utters this command. We don't know why this command is here, but it is what it is. We know that there's a command because things exist.
Mm-hmm.
That's at least the perspective that the Ismailis would take. And from the command of God, this, which is an eternal command, it is a continuous command, reality will unfold, but it will unfold hierarchically.
Mm-hmm.
So the direct result of God's command will not be this imperfect, limited universe. It will only be, by logic, one entity.
Mm-hmm.
If multiple entities came from God's act, it would imply some multiplicity in God. So only one entity comes forth. That one entity, if it was imperfect, there would be some imperfection in God.
Mm-hmm.
So the one entity that comes forth first must be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ismailis identified the first created being, the first perfect being, with the universal intellect,
mm-hmm.
the nous
yep.
of Plotinus. And this perfect being, the universal intellect, contains the forms of all things. To put it in today's vernacular, it contains eternal universal truths.
Mm-hmm.
Things like mathematic truths, some would say the truths of the laws of logic, any sort of proposition that we know has to be true all the time. Some would even say certain moral laws
mm-hmm.
are contained in the universal intellect. So that's the first being, and this first being is perfect. It, by its very nature, it recognizes God.
Mm-hmm.
It says symbolically, there is no God but God. So that's the intellect's testimony. In Muslim terms, that's the Shahada.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Muslim declaration of faith is there is no God but God. What
yep.
the Ismailis do is they say the first being to say that is the universal intellect. Because the universal intellect is perfect, it overflows with being. And that is emanation.
Mm.
And from the emanation of the universal intellect, the universal soul comes forth.
Mm-hmm.
And this universal soul is almost perfect. it can't, if it's not exactly perfect, or else it would be the intellect. So it's right. almost perfect. Mm-hmm. And this universal soul, of course, it desires perfection, as every being does. And in order to actualize perfection, because it's come from perfection, mm-hmm. so therefore it has the potential to reach perfection. To actualize the perfection, the universal soul will contemplate, it contemplates the intellect, and it gives form to that contemplation, its attempt to make itself perfect, mm-hmm. and that is the act of generation of the cosmos. Mm. So that sort of completes your model. And in the cosmos that we see this universe, according to this way of looking of, at things, which I think even in modern terms could be intellectually revived. Mm-hmm. One would say that the intelligibility of the universe as humans experience it, that the ground of that intelligibility is the universal intellect. Mm-hmm. It contains the essences. But we don't just see intelligibility in the universe, we see movement. We see continuous change, but we see goal-directed activity. Mm-hmm. For example, many would say in this tradition and today, the laws of nature, the regularities by which nature behaves, that is goal-directed activity. Mm-hmm. And the universal soul is the exemplar, the ground of that goal-directed activity. So this sort of gives you this sort of complete Neoplatonic worldview, which I think has a lot in common with
right, yeah. It's very interesting to see these various, these traditions that have kind of the emanationist cosmologies and where they put that split, right? Because that seems to be where the differences are between them. You know, so you're, the split, if I understand this correctly, is kind of right at the top. And then in Gnosticism, it's somewhere in the middle. And then Neoplatonism, there's not really a split, but it's kind of, you know, water flowing downhill kind of a thing. So, yeah, it's... All interesting interpretations of the same problem. Yeah,
and even same this process. This yeah. This notion of the divine spark. Mm-hmm. I mean, in this worldview, human souls are microcosms of the universal soul, mm-hmm. and every human soul has this spark, mm-hmm. which is the spark is from the intellect.
That's interesting. Is there a twofold division of man in this system? Is it body and soul, or is there another part to it? Or
it depends who you read, sure. of course. Yeah. But a prevalent view in the classical Ismaili tradition. Of course, everything I've just said, this is the classical Ismaili yeah. thinkers, and it gets elaborated further.
Sure.
But it's really intellect, soul. Body.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And even within the human soul itself consists of at least a rational soul, which is the discursive faculty. Mm-hmm. So intellect's higher than that. Mm-hmm. So the human soul has rational soul, animal soul, and vegetative soul, responsible for rationality. The animal soul is, discursive rational soul is for rationality, animal soul is for fear and anger, and the vegetative soul is for growth, attraction to pleasure, these sorts of things.
I'm fascinated by that stuff.
That's very, and it sounds very familiar, and it's very similar to lots of stuff in our tradition.
Yeah.
Talking about sort of a point that Father Tony mentioned, where did things kind of go wrong in this thought? Like, why, sort of in Gnosticism, there is a break at some point during these emanations, or in some forms of Gnosticism. Again, Gnosticism is sort of a family of traditions, even classic Gnosticism. So you talk about the universal soul sort of overflows, and then the cosmos is created. But why do bad things happen on Earth? Is it left as a divine mystery, or is it something to do with this process, or what is kind of the Ismaili thought on this when connecting it to the cosmology?
So this is a very, very good question. So there's really two things to say about it. So there is no real break here. There's no sort of disaster in the Pleroma. There are other Ismaili cosmologists of the another Ismaili tradition, which is worth describing, and they have this idea of 10 intellects, mm-hmm. no universal soul. Mm. It's God, command of God, 10 intellects. And how do they explain the 10 intellects? They say that there was a first intellect, that emanated a second, and that emanated a third. And each of these intellects recognized the authority of the one above them mm-hmm. and testified to God. So that was all good. In this system, the third intellect fails to recognize properly the authority of the two above him, mm-hmm. and the third intellect goes into a stupor, sort of like a point of confusion, and it finally comes out of the stupor, and it finds that it's dropped from third to tenth. And that it's this tenth intellect now wants to go back to the third level where it belongs. How does it do that? It needs help. So it creates souls, it sort of manifests, it fragments into different souls and a cosmos through which these souls will purify themselves, they'll become perfect, and through the effort of these different souls, 10th intellect will jump up to the 9th. And then the guy, you know, one human being, sort of like the Matrix, one human being, the last Imam, will become the 10th intellect, and then he'll create again.
No.
You know, wow. And this will repeat itself 7 times until the 10th has returned back to the 3rd. That's more sort of along the lines of these Gnostic cosmologies that we're familiar with. Yes. But the one that I was describing, which was more mainstream, the imperfection begins at the level of the universal soul. Mm-hmm. It's this not the intellect. Mm-hmm. And the universal soul creates a cosmos that is on the road to perfection, but obviously suffers from imperfections. Mm-hmm. Right? Because the universal soul has both. It has potential perfection, but it has actual imperfection. Mm-hmm. So its creative product will have some perfect beings and a lot of imperfect beings. So in Ismaili sort of cosmology, the perfect souls that the universal soul creates are the souls of the prophets and the Imams. Mm-hmm. But the rest of the souls could be perfect. They just need the guidance of the perfect souls. Mm-hmm. And so then, you know, this relates to why do bad things happen? Ultimately, anything that is not the universal intellect will suffer from privation, just by being what it is.
Yeah.
Everything was totally perfect, and without any privation, there would be no. It wouldn't be the cosmos.
Yeah.
Right.
It would be something else. Yeah. That sounds a lot like Jacob Boehme. That sounds very similar to me. His explanation of how creation is complete but imperfect on its way to becoming complete and perfect.
Yeah.
These ideas don't exist in a vacuum, I suppose.
What's amazing in my own studies has been to see. And I've studied some Catholic thought and some Christian mysticism, Meister Eckhart. Mm-hmm. So I have an article, maybe you'll be interested, published in Sacred Web. Mm-hmm. Sacred Web is this journal of esoteric thought, comparing Meister Eckhart's mystical interpretation of the Trinity mm-hmm. to Ismaili Neoplatonism.
Very interesting.
It's a two-part article, and you'll see a lot of sort of synergy between, of course they're not the same.
Sure.
But you'll see a lot of, you know, crossovers mm-hmm. In conception. So it's amazing as a student, someone who studies this academically, the sort of commonalities that you find. And actually, it shouldn't surprise us. Today, as modern people, we divide people based on religion, and then we divide religions based on civilizations. Mm-hmm. We treat Islam and Christianity and Hinduism, even though Hinduism is a construct, as separate worlds. Mm. But as you guys all know, for a lot of the medieval period, from really as soon as Islam comes on the scene, Muslims, Christians, Jews, even what are today called Hindus, Zoroastrians, they're all working out of a common pool of cultural, intellectual concepts and vocabulary. Mm-hmm. So Thomas Aquinas is reading Al-Farabi and Ibn Sina, mm-hmm. except through Latin translation. So he mixes up a little bit of what they say. Moses Maimonides, probably the most famous Jewish theologian, he lives under the domain of the Ismaili Fatimid Empire. Mm-hmm. And Moses Maimonides adopts a lot of Ismaili positions and critiques some of them, but some of them he loves. Mm-hmm. And he flourished in that environment and in Andalusia. in the 12th, 13th century. You have, you know, this civilization of Jews, Christians, Muslims, they're all working together. Mm-hmm. So this is this division between Christendom and Muslim civilization, it's artificial.
Mm-hmm.
It's at least it's not as separate as we think they are today. We all come from a shared heritage. And if one wants to deny the cultural heritage, I would propose that we have a common ethical heritage
mm-hmm.
behind these different faith traditions. And Gnosis, I think, is of all these different traditions, the Gnosis is this, you know, paramount expression of that common ground and at least common aspirations.
Mm. Makes sense to me.
Yeah. I think a lot of Christians and secular people in the West are surprised that in all of Islam, Jesus is a prophet. He plays an important role. He's in the Quran. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about Jesus' role in the faith, and if in Ismaili thought, does he have two natures, one human and one divine?
Yes, it's a very good question. So let me just begin in general. I'm not sure if you guys have read the Quranic verses on Jesus and Mary. But
I have.
Okay, so you have. So, you know, Mary is mentioned more in the Quran than mm-hmm. she is in the Gospels. Mm-hmm. And Jesus in the Quran is presented as a Israelite prophet. You could say that the Quran returns Jesus to his Jewish context, sort of as a, it's making a counter commentary to the more Romanized
mm-hmm.
Jesus, for better or for worse. So we need to remember that the Quran, every verse of the Quran is addressing in its literal meaning the audience of 7th century Arabia.
Right.
So, because those are the people who the Prophet Muhammad was talking with.
Mm-hmm.
So the Quran is speaking a lot to beliefs about Jesus prevalent in 7th century Arabia that do not necessarily reflect Orthodox, Catholic, and Gnostic Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
So the Quranic criticism of Christian belief seems to me, anyway, a criticism of what even today's Christians would call heresy.
Mm-hmm.
So the Quran criticizes those who say God is Jesus. It's like, you know, this monophysite
mm-hmm.
view,
mm-hmm.
right? It criticizes the adoptionists. It criticizes those who say God is third of three. A trinity that has Jesus, God, and Mary.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are Arabian tribes that believe that.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't even think the Quran's Christology is a direct confrontation with the Christology of mainstream and Gnostic Christianity. I, for one, don't think that.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus in the Quran is called a prophet of God, a messenger of God. He's also called the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
And he's called a spirit of God. And he's also referred to as being guided or supported by the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the raw material. Now let's sort of move to the Ismaili discourses on Jesus. So Ismailis believe, at least the classical thinkers, mind you, among the Ismaili community today, people have all kinds of different views. So when I refer to the Ismailis, I'm really talking about, you know, sort of established Ismaili theologians from history. I don't mean to sort of represent,
sure.
you know, the views of a very diverse community today.
Mm-hmm.
So these Ismaili perspectives on Jesus, firstly, they view Jesus as one of the most important prophets since Adam and Eve. It is believed that there have been many prophets, but there are six prophets that are preeminent. Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad.
Mm-hmm.
And together with the whole line of Imams, you have seven.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of like in Ebionite Christianity, the seven pillars of the house of wisdom. Mm-hmm. So Jesus is number five.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ismailis understood every prophet and his mission to be akin to a stage of fetal development.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the Quran describes the development of a embryo to a child in seven stages.
Mm.
It says first it's a drop, and then it becomes bones, and then flesh. And there's a whole seven-step process, and Ismailis read that verse, and they said, this is not talking about the physical embryo, really. It's talking about the world of faith, that God, through sending these prophets, is giving, is engendering, or rather, to be precise, the universal soul is giving birth to the perfect humanity through sending these prophets. So Jesus already plays an important role in that. Each prophet, each of these great prophets, and then the imams after, they are seen as the human beings who reflect the universal intellect. So this is not incarnation. It is what you would call manifestation. So that is to say that, firstly, the universal intellect is not a person.
Right.
It's not, it doesn't have, like, you know, like, intentions and wants and all this. So it's not a person. It is a reality. But the prophets are persons, and the imam is a person. But they are not just ordinary persons. Their persons are so pure that they are able to reflect, as far as any human can, the qualities of the universal intellect. So Jesus is seen as this. Does that mean he has two natures? Some Ismaili thinkers have described Jesus and each of these prophets and imams as having two natures. A human nature, which refers to their human soul. Because, you know, the, when we talk about a person, we're really talking about a soul, we're not really talking about a body. So the I-ness of every person is his soul. So every imam and every prophet has that I-ness. So Jesus has that too. So that's his human nature. And then that human nature at all times is containing, or is a reflection of, the universal intellect, which you could call a divine nature, but the term divine doesn't need to be used. You could call it a celestial nature. So those are the two natures of Jesus. But then in this, of course, Jesus is not unique. But he is. Jesus is a bringer of light. He is a teacher of truth. Jesus guides, you know, his disciples and those who believe in him back to the universal intellect. And I just add that Ismailis in the past recognized these other faith traditions as legitimate paths to attaining spiritual perfection. Even today, the Ismaili Imam, the Aga Khan, preaches pluralism. He says that nobody has the monopoly over truth, that we all have something to learn from one another, because, you know, no nation, no religion, no ideology can claim to possess exclusive truth, you know, where everyone else is condemned. Pluralism means we all have something to contribute, we all have something to learn from each other, and that there are multiple paths to God. That doesn't mean they're all equally legitimate. People can debate which is better. But just to say that one path is better than the other does not mean the other is condemned.
That's I think most Gnostics would recognize that. I think so. The Jonathan, do you want to throw anything else in here before we throw it to some audience questions?
I think we're I think I'm good, and I know we are running out of time, so we may want to get to these.
I did actually have one more just before we before we slide into that. You mentioned in the I think in the video portion the imams are kind of the people with the gnosis, right? When do they get that gnosis? I mean, maybe that's a weird question, but
it's a very good question.
Do they get it when they become the imam, or is it something that you have to have in order to become the imam?
So this has been, of course, a subject that different Muslim thinkers have discussed in different Shia traditions. The Ismaili tradition, you do actually have a consistent answer, in the sense that one of the past imam answered the question straight up. So the 23rd imam of the Ismailis, his name is Imam Hassan, he said, and this is documented in the a publication by the Institute of Ismaili Studies called The Paradise of Submission, so people can check that out. And the 23rd imam says that the imam is always spiritually perfect, even when he's born. So the Imam is born with this light, with Gnosis.
Mm-hmm.
But that Imam will only start functioning as the Imam when the preceding Imam has died.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. So that's been sort of the clear answer. Now, contemporary perspective, people can still sort of debate this question. People in the Ismaili community may talk about it. It's less important today because nobody can really follow someone as an Imam until the current Imam designates him.
Right.
And it's become the policy, it seems anyway, of the contemporary Imams where they name their successor in their will.
Mm.
And the will is read out, at least in the case of the 48th Imam, when he passed away, his will was read out like after he died.
Mm-hmm.
So there was, even during his lifetime, nobody knew who the next Imam was.
Mm. And the Imams are infallible in the Ismaili tradition?
The word infallible, of course, is a borrowed from the Catholic tradition.
Yeah.
But what you do find in historical Ismaili discourses is that the Imams and the Prophets, so Sunni Muslims believe that this is true for the Prophet Muhammad, and all Shia Muslims believe that the Imams are protected from committing errors and sins, protected by God. I don't know if infallible is the best translation of that.
Right.
It may not be. Because of that, Shia Muslims in general believe that the Imam is always giving correct guidance. So the Imam definitely cannot, you know, go astray in terms of his spiritual guide. Otherwise, he wouldn't be the Imam. He would just be like a scholar or anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely, the guidance of the Imam is always true. That is really the basis of why he is an Imam.
Mm. But could the Imam be wrong about, say, being a Cubs fan or something? Something not spiritual.
You know, this is something that's debated to this day. In the certain past discourses, so discourses from the 13th century, some philosophers have written that the Imam, you know, cannot be wrong on anything.
Mm.
But, you know, these are all, when we talk about infallibility or what have you, we have to recognize that, you know, all theology are really attempts of believers to understand their experience
mm-hmm.
of the faith. And it's a very positive thing, but usually theology is not at the same level as the Imam's teaching.
Mm-hmm.
So when an Imam has said something that it's authoritative, then one can do all the theological speculation that they want. It can be fruitful, right? But it does, just because a theologian has said something, it doesn't mean that that is the Imam's own sort of position.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. On things. So in all of this, the Imam is like the chief, you know, he's the sole interpreter to determine what Islam should be
mm-hmm.
for his community. And then within that umbrella of the Imam's guidance, members of the Ismaili community will engage in philosophical and theological exploration,
mm-hmm.
Giving their best efforts. And that's where all these cosmologies are coming from. But we should not sort of put them at the same level as the Imam's teaching, which is sort of meta. It's meta theology, meta theological.
Yeah. All right, got it, thank you. All right, so we asked the fans on our Facebook page for some questions. Let's see. Okay, so Kaleem Kassan asks, the Ismailis are often thought of as being an antinomian sect. To support this view are the dictum attributed to Hassan bin Sabah, nothing is true, everything is permitted. Not a question exactly, but I guess he wants to get your opinion on what that on that.
So Hassani Sabah was a Ismaili philosopher, part of the Ismaili mission at the end of the 11th century, and he became a major leader of the of Ismaili communities in Persia. There are a lot of legends about him that are not true. The term assassin, coming from the word hashashin, people who do hash,
mm-hmm.
was applied to Hassani Sabah and his community of Ismailis. It's completely wrong.
Mm.
these Ismailis never did hash. As for assassination, we have to understand that in the Ismailis in the end of the 11th century and through the 12th and 13th centuries, because the Ismaili Imams were ruling as Fatimid caliphs, the Sunni Abbasid caliphs saw the Ismailis as almost public enemy number one, you know, as a political disturbance. And there was a purge in the early 12th century. The whole Abbasid Seljuk administration went through some sort of an inquisition where they tried to find out which of their officers are Ismailis, and tens of thousands of people were executed on suspicion of being Ismaili. And Ismaili communities at this time and even before were being slaughtered. I mean, genocide has occurred in the past. Now, how does a community protect itself against a genocidal act that a military general or a vizier or a caliph can bring against you any time? So at that time, the assassination of political and military leaders was common warfare. The Abbasids did it, the Seljuks did it, different parties in a court would do assassinations. So the Ismailis of that, you know, late 11th and 12th century, to protect their community from being targeted by these generals and officers and viziers, would also order assassinations. That was the only way to protect a vulnerable minority whose fortresses are sort of surrounded by hostile forces. And it's unfortunate that the term assassin has been so turned around. Now, Hassan Isawa never said that quote, that nothing is permitted. This antinomianism is a trope. It's just something that people like to sort of say. It has no truth to it. The Ismailis have maintained the highest ethical standards and self-discipline in their community, and it continues till the present day. I think what happens generally, though, is unfortunately, because Sunni Islam historically has been very law-centric, Islamic law has been used as a yardstick to measure the Muslimness of other communities, including the Ismailis. And for the Ismailis, although they had formal law during the time, and by law I don't mean like simple rules of living, but I mean this, you know, this very detailed jurisprudence where there's every possible situation there's a ruling. That's what I mean by Islamic law. So Ismailis have had that at times, but at other times they have really de-emphasized the law. Of course, they've always maintained the ethical aspects of living. That has always been there. But formal jurisprudence has often been de-emphasized because Ismailis historically did not define Islam as law. Today,
well, and they have the Imam for that, right?
Right. Yeah. So when you have a living Imam who is providing guidance on moral issues, on religious rituals, law in and of itself is not really necessary. At least jurisprudence is not necessary. Jurisprudence was only necessary when they had the Fatimid Caliphate, and the Caliphate needs a law. So I'm saying this because, look, in the Quran, there's very little law. The Prophet Muhammad has very little legal teachings, actually. Islamic law is a construct by jurists 300, 400, 500 years after the Prophet, law is constructed. So there's no reason to subject a non-Sunni minority community to the yardstick of, well, do they have law or not? If they don't have law, then they must not be legit. That there's no need to do that.
Very interesting. All right, Ibrahim Alevi says, how does Ismailism reconcile its monist view of God with God's utter transcendence? Well, we talked a little bit about that earlier, I think.
Oh, yeah, I was just about to say I want to move on to the next one since we tackled it.
Yeah, go ahead, Jonathan.
Oh, I was just going to, well, the Alias asked, why did philosophy and science come to an end in the 12th century in the Muslim world? Which I don't know if that's an accurate question, but how do Ismailis today reconcile science and religion?
Oh, I mean, it's a good question. So the first question is something I often hear from people who follow Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Okay.
So Neil deGrasse Tyson, I mean,
yeah, that's a bit of a leading question, isn't
very,
it?
Very, very good at, you know, talking about science of today, but his knowledge of Muslim history and civilization is severely lacking.
Mm-hmm.
He actually said that, you know, science and philosophy came to an end in the 12th century. It's simply not true. This is another one of those tropes that many sort of Orientalist scholars used to say. Why? Because Ghazali, a Sunni thinker, wrote a tract called The Incoherence of the Philosophers, where he argued with he disputed out of like about 20 or so beliefs of Ibn Sina and other Neoplatonists. He only disputed three of them. Mm-hmm. He said the rest are fine. And the thing is, Ghazali uses philosophical methods of argument to argue with the philosophers. And he's very philosophical. And a lot of Orientalists said, well, look, it's Ghazali's fault. But it's really not true. Philosophy has continued to be vibrant from the 12th century onward. What has happened, though, is that the Muslim world, due to different factors like colonization, and British colonialism and all these developments, the Muslim world has not benefited from the technological revolution that Western and European countries have benefited from. And there's many reasons for that. You know, the Middle East was divided after World War I by the Allied powers, and, mm-hmm. and new borders, arbitrary borders, were drawn, and this has just created a lot of instability
mm-hmm.
In some parts of the Muslim world. The second question was about science and religion.
Yeah.
So this is I think it's very relevant. And I'd like to hear a sort of Christian Gnostic approach
sure.
to this. Mm-hmm. So how do Ismailis sort of go about doing that? Well, I mean, individual Ismailis can go about it very different ways, but I can sort of reference what the Aga Khan himself has said about science and religion.
Mm-hmm.
So in the 1980s, this issue came up, and the Aga Khan, over several speeches, explained that there is no conflict, and there could never be a conflict between science and religion. Why is that? Well, he said that in Muslim belief, God is eternal, and God's creative act, the act of creation, is eternal.
Mm-hmm.
So if God is creating all the time, from a human perspective, God is creating all the time, right? And I explained that sort of hierarchy.
Yeah.
So in the Neoplatonic terms, God by means of his command that manifests through the universal intellect and universal soul is always creating the cosmos. And therefore, every human act of discovery is also an act of creation.
Mm.
To put it in different terms, and within this theological paradigm, when a human being, the human mind, the human intellect, which is created, comes upon new knowledge, from a metaphysical perspective, God, through these intermediaries, is simultaneously creating that knowledge.
Mm.
So now, who should be taking credit for the scientific discoveries? I mean, the theologian would say, well, it's both. Man has simply discovered something new of God's creation. Right? So mm-hmm. then there does not need to be a conflict. And also, what are the definitions of science and religion? I mean, science, I think, if you think about it, science is talking about describing and modeling in a predictable way the behavior of things.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is, of course, entirely legitimate, but metaphysics is involved in explaining the nature of things,
mm-hmm.
not just their behavior. So theology, metaphysics, and religion ultimately is people are trying to find meaning through the nature of things. It's not just about studying the behavior so you can predict them. So science and religion or metaphysics, they're doing different things, and there definitely does not need to be a conflict, because one can't really replace the other.
Sure. Yeah, I'm of the opinion that Neil deGrasse Tyson should probably stay in his lane when it comes to. I know, controversial, but yeah, he's great on astrophysics, but let the philosophers do philosophy. And there was a lot of people in my Facebook feed were fairly upset with him when he made his statement about how, you know, philosophy is useless and everybody should stop doing it.
What are you going to do? I think we're almost at time, right, Father?
Just about. I haven't really been keeping track.
Okay. Yeah, I would like to go all night. Khalil, I also want to thank you because, to be honest, when we do the show, oftentimes, we have guests on and we're exploring topics we're quite familiar with, and maybe we want to get information out there or discourse on a topic that we know well. And I can't speak for Father Tony, but what I know about Islam and Islam could fill about a thimble. So, or did before the show. So I personally learned quite a bit, and everything you said is quite interesting and fascinating. And to think that this is a living tradition, you know, because I'm used to a lot of coming across thought like this in dusty old books. Well, my e-reader. But I did want to ask or close out to talk a little bit about kind of getting off topic a little bit, but of course it's election year in the United States, and there's been a lot of rhetoric about Islam and about Muslims. And I want to ask, you know, about is Islam inherently a violent religion? Is it a religion of peace? And I have heard that many victims of terrorism around the world are actually Muslims, and in many cases, Shia or Ismaili. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
No, absolutely. I mean, it's a very timely question. So, you know, we can close with this. So firstly, you know, a believer could say his religion is about peace or war or whatever it is. I think that the academic study of religion gives us a better way to approach this question. Religions, whether it's Christianity, Islam, religions are not these entities that exist sort of in the air, independent of people.
Right.
That's the first thing. So religion, whether Islam or Christianity, is neither peaceful nor violent. It doesn't exist apart from people. Religion really is what people do, what people believe, how, you know, what people aspire to. So let's just make that qualifier first.
Sure.
So if we want to talk about Islam, I think we should really be talking about what Muslims think and believe. Okay, now, why did this question come up? And there's, you know, why are people asking this question, is Islam violent? Either they mean Muslims are violent, or they think Islam is this entity that exists independent of Muslims, and basically, because they've read certain portions of the Quran that they think are violent, they think, well, this Islam is simply what the Quran says, so therefore it must be violent. That's usually the argument. So I want to sort of shut this thing down once and for all. So the first thing, what do we know about Muslims? Well, we know there's probably more than 1.5 billion Muslims in the world. Now, some studies have been done on the media, and I forget the exact source, but Professor Shafiq Virani of University of Toronto has a TED talk about this, and he cites a study that found that over 95% of media stories about Muslims cast them in a negative light.
Really?
95%.
Now, here's the thing. There's 1.5 billion Muslims. At most, only 100,000 of them are these militant groups. Mm-hmm. That is less than 0.01%, probably less than 0.001%. So this tiny little speck of this huge circle, so the most of these 99.9% of 1.5 billion Muslims around the world are peaceful, they're not violent, and they're simply wanting to live a quality of life like the rest of us. That's it. So that's the first point. The second point is, as you already mentioned, the biggest victims of militant groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda, the biggest victims of them are Muslims. Mm-hmm. Muslims hate these groups. You know, it's like saying, to use another example, a group of people is being murdered, and people then say to the victims, you guys support murder. It makes no sense, right? It's nonsense. The third point, if we compare the attitudes of American Muslims, what do we find about them? American Muslims are very much like other Americans. And I'll just cite the results of a poll, for example, about American Muslims. So, for example, they found that the same amount, around 40% of American Muslims, take their faith seriously. That's the same percentage, I think, for as Catholics and Protestants.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Right? So how different are American Muslims than other Americans? They're very, very similar. In fact, Gallup polls around Muslims worldwide found that, in general, Muslims, both in America and in other countries, are more likely to condemn military acts against civilians.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, less numbers of Protestants, Catholics, Jews, and Mormons, and atheists, less numbers, less percentages of them per polls would condemn military action against civilians. And that's just to put the numbers in context. So clearly the problem is not Muslims. Muslims are not violent. So the last thing people usually say is, okay, well, the Muslims may not be violent, but the Quran is violent. So I'll just give a couple of examples. Number one, 7th century Arabia, when Prophet Muhammad began his mission, was a stateless area. So there's no state. There are no governments. There's no UN. So peace is not the default. A state of war is the default.
Mm-hmm.
Tribes would be fighting with each other all the time. Raiding was a regular part of life. War was almost an everyday occurrence. And two scholars, Michael Bonner and Fred Donner, who are scholars of early Islam, they make this very explicit point.
Mm-hmm.
So any community, in Muhammad's community, when they had, for 13 years, they were persecuted, they fled, they went to another, they formed a new state. And their default relationship with their neighbors was a one of war.
Mm-hmm.
So the Quran says, verse 22:40, permission to fight is given to those against whom war is made. The Quran only allows defensive war. It does not allow anyone to start hostilities. The Quran also says, for example, in many verses, that if the other side wants peace, then make peace.
Mm-hmm.
It actually tells the Muslims, if you have a peace treaty, so peace treaties meant there's peace. Mm-hmm. Today, peace is the default, right? But in 7th century Arabia, there's only peace if there's a treaty. Mm-hmm. So the Quran says in Surah 9, for example, those who you have treaties with, you are not to attack. You're not to engage in hostilities with them. And another verse in Surah 9:6 says, if any of the polytheists seeks your protection, give it to him.
Mm-hmm.
Protect him. So there's no justification, nowhere in the Quran are Muslims allowed or even commanded to commit acts of violence against people they are at peace with. The Quran says, interestingly, it says there's no compulsion in religion. And I'll read this one verse, and it really emphasizes the attitude. So I'm making this point because we have certain people going on media, on Fox News, on CBN News, called experts of Islam. And when I Google their names, I find out they're really Christian apologists.
Yep.
They're evangelical Christians calling themselves experts on Islam.
Yep.
And they're saying, you know, the Quran is encouraging violence, and it's completely false. But what does the Quran actually say about Jews and Christians? So here's what it says. This is a very important verse. And this is not about whether one believes in the Quran or not. I mean, I'm looking at this academically,
right.
And for me as an academic, the Quran is the earliest source of Muslim history.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter who wrote the Quran. This is a documentary source. So the Quran says, in chapter 2, verse 62, verily, those who have faith, and those who are Jews, and those who are Christians, and those who are Sabians, and whoever has faith in God and the Day of Judgment and works righteousness, surely their reward is with their Lord, and there shall come upon them no fear, nor shall they grieve. This is the Quran
mm-hmm.
saying, hey, you want salvation? You really just need to have faith in God and do good.
Mm.
It's not about whether you're Muslim or Christian
yeah.
or Jewish. That's the Quranic attitude toward humankind. The Quran says, chapter 4, verse 1, that God has created all humans from one soul. Neoplatonically, that's the universal soul. Mm-hmm. So all people are going, I've come from one origin, human beings are linked. And I think what we really need against this Islamophobia is the idea, what the Aga Khan and others call a cosmopolitan ethic. An ethic that is not marginalizing any people and that upholds quality of life regardless of one's faith.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for those examples. I kind of wish we lived in a world where we didn't have to ask questions like that, but what are you going to do? I saw an interesting video. I think it was a Danish video. There's a guy, because it was subtitled, and he was going around saying, hey, listen, I'm going to read you these quotes out of the Quran. Tell me what you think. And he's reading this like awful, violent stuff, and people are saying, yeah, no, that's terrible, that's terrible. And he goes, actually, that's the Bible. Yeah. And so, you know, it's a product of the time when it was written, and you know, you're going to find that stuff everywhere. And as you mentioned, religions are made of people. It's and some people are dicks, and that's all there is to it.
Yeah. I'll just mention one thing at the end. The reason why we have these conversations, why these questions are being asked, and why politicians are allowed to make these statements, and the public buys it, is that we today are not religiously literate.
Oh, yeah.
So there's a lack of religious literacy. And I wanted to just share that Harvard University, where I'm at, has put on, Harvard Divinity School, has put on a series of courses about the scriptures of every major religion.
That's right, yeah.
For free. Mm-hmm. Anybody can take it.
I saw that, yeah.
Right? And you can learn how to, you know, the hope is that people will do these courses and they will learn some religious literacy.
I'm making a note here. I'm going to see if I can find that link and throw that in the show notes here. Yeah. Anyway, we're over time, so thank you once again for joining us. It's been a fascinating conversation. I know I've learned a lot, and I hope, Jonathan, got all your questions in that you were looking for. But we'd love to have you back and maybe dig into some of these concepts in a little more detail. And since you're right down the street in Cambridge, that sounds like it'd be pretty easy. Anyway, so we'll put your links in the description of the video again to academia.edu and all that. And thank you once again for joining us.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. And for those of you who are listening along at home, we will see you next week.
Good night, everybody.
This has been a production of the Gnostic Wisdom Network. For more information about this and all of GWN's programming, please visit gnosticwisdom.net. The opinions expressed in this show do not necessarily reflect the opinions of GWN, the Apostolic Johannite Church, or any other organization. This has been released under a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 4.0 International License, and is brought to you by the generous support of our patrons. To support our programs and become a patron, please visit patreon.com/Gnostic. That's patreon.com/GNOSTIC.